beginning with Dr. Yasser Iturria-Medina, who is an assistant professor here in the Department of Neurology and Neurosurgery, and also a principal investigator at the Ludmer Center for Neuroinformatics and Mental Health, where he is the head of the Neuroinformatics for Personalized Medicine Lab. Among its chief objectives, Yasser's lab aims to define and implement multiscale and multifactorial brain models for understanding neurological disorders and identifying effective personalized interventions. So in addition to being responsible for the scientific content for today's workshop, Yasser will also now speak to us about multifactorial brain models for understanding neurodegenerative progression and individual therapeutic needs. Welcome, Yasser.
Hi, thank you for coming. As Patrick mentioned, I will be talking about how multifactorial brain models could help to understand underlying mechanisms in neurodegenerative disorders and how they could also help to identify individual therapeutic needs. In 2015, a paper published in Nature reported how the 10 most sold drugs in the US only help around 4 to 25% of all the patients that are taking them. Even when that was 4 years ago, and the numbers might be a little bit better now, we are still, the situation is still very sad. For example, the drug most sold for schizophrenia is only helping around 20% of all the patients that are taking it. The most popular drug for depression is only helping at 12%, and for multiple sclerosis only at 7%. A key question would be why the patients continue taking drugs that are not working for them, and also, of course, why the medical doctors continue prescribing these drugs, knowing that they have so low success. And of course, a direct reply to that question would be because we are still in the times of the generalized medicine, and that's why we are meeting today here. As you know, generalized medicines consider similar risks, similar doses, similar responses from all the patients with the same clinical diagnosis, while by the contrary, personalized medicine considers the differences in risk, doses, and the differences in response to the treatments. However, the main ideas of the personalized medicine, and for 50 years ago, some people even consider that they are coming from 2,000 years ago, and we are not still there. So personalized medicine, at least in the neurological context, is not practical yet. There are multiple methodological limitations associated to this. I would say one of the most important is that we are still, or in general, we are still work at a low dimensional level. So we see a lot of segregation and a lot of separation between different fields. There is not enough integration of different kind of data. When in fact, as you know, each brain state is the result of the interaction between different scales, like for example, the interaction between genes, proteins, synapses, neurons, local sequences, and brain networks. Just to say an example, like usually in the neuroimaging community, we work at the brain networks, but we don't consider the different scales that contribute to see a given result in a brain image. Also, there is a notable lack of causal and predictive analysis and abuse of an association. For example, we usually see the use of correlation and regression to make causal interpretations of the underlying mechanisms of a given disease. And also, we continue to use broad clinical categories to validate the new subtype of patients that we are finding, when that, in fact, implies a singularity, because we can, if we start from the point that the clinical data or the clinical data is not good enough to identify biological mechanisms or individual therapeutic needs, why would we use that data to make the validation of the new subtypes? I will comment now about the work that we are trying to that we are doing to try to overcome some of these limitations. In fact, the main message from this part is that, of course, we cannot implement personalized medicine or precision medicine without having a causal understanding of how the brain and the body works. We, some years ago, around 6 years ago, we started trying to interrelate different scales in the brain. And for that, we started with creating mathematical models to understand better the interaction that happens between toxic proteins and connectomes, which, as you know, happens in aging and neurodegeneration. As probably you know, the prion light hypothesis proposed or explains the neurodegeneration by the intercellular transference of misfolded proteins, which start in some specific brain regions and propagate from those regions to the other regions of the brain. According to this hypothesis, each disorder will be characterized by a set of misfolded proteins which follow a specific anatomical patterns in the propagation. 6 years ago, we proposed an epidemic spreading model of misfolded proteins to understand better that intrabrain propagation. And according to that model, the change in probability of finding misfolded proteins in one brain region will be a function of the probability of receiving the misfolded protein from the other regions in the brain. And to know which regions are connected with that one, we could use a priori information coming from, for example, diffusion MRI, but we could use diffusion MRI tractography, but we could also use information coming from track traced studies. Less the probability of clearing the deposited misfolded proteins, which could be done by the glia, by the vascular lymphatic system, etc. Plus less stochastic events or standard inputs, like if the person is doing physical exercise, is the which kind of food is eating the person, the environmental conditions, if the person is taking drugs. This kind of model can be translated mathematically to a set of differential equations, in this case a set of nonlinear differential equations, which will be depending of course, the connectivity between each pair of regions, but also of two main parameters, in this case, the production rates of the misfolded proteins and the cleaning rate of the misfolded proteins. In order to validate or have an initial validation of the model, we used amyloid PET imaging for over 700 patients, and then a given brain parcellation that allowed us to obtain real amyloid deposition values for all the gray matter. And then using our model and structural connectivity for Jones obvious, we simulated around 50 years of life for each patient, which we changed or by changing the initial set of parameters that allowed us to optimize the parameters of the model until we obtained individual parameters expressing production and clearing rate of the misfolded proteins in each subject. We were then interested to see how the model parameters will be related to the clinical states of the subjects. And then, surprisingly for us, at that time, we found that the clearance of the or the parameters representing the clearance of the misfolded proteins were significantly more associated than any other parameter like production to the clinical state of the subjects. And in fact, that the subjects that develop Alzheimer's, they have a significantly lower capacity to clean the producing misfolded protein or amyloid in the brains compared with the subjects that were healthy controls. However, if we, once that we consider all the parameters together, they were only able to explain around a 30% in the variance of the clinical states. We suggested that two things. The model was not good enough capturing the propagation of the misfolded proteins, or the misfolded proteins are not enough to explain the clinical disorders that we observe in a population. So we moved then to consider all the biological factors. We extended the previous model to consider, for example, different biological factors like could be cerebrovascular flow, brain activity at rest, glucose metabolism. And then we proposed this model according to which the change in a given biological factor at a given region, let's say if there is an increase in before the protein deposition in amyloid or in tau, or if there is a decrease in cerebrovascular flow, that will be a function now of all the direct interactions between the different biological factors at that region, and that this will be causal interactions, not associations. plus the incoming effects from other brain regions. We know similar to that in the case of the MeFolder proteins, let's say vascular alterations or structural alterations, functional alterations, they propagate across the brain, and they propagate across different physical networks, like could be the vascular network, the anatomical network, the lymphatic system, plus less, again, standard inputs, like if a person is taking drugs or if the person is doing physical exercise. Again, this general model can be translated to a set of differential equations. This is just a simple version of it. But essentially what we are considering here on the left side are the change in all the properties that we are measuring in the brain. And we express them as a function of all the interactions between different biological factors and the intra-brain propagation of those alterations, plus the incoming standard effects. Then we could also define equations or ways to characterize how these alterations, intra-brain alterations, impact condition, clinical state, any behavioral property. I should mention before presenting the data that these kind of dynamic system equations and control theories I use it every day in many engineering applications since the last probably 60, 70 years. They are used in civil engineering, electrical engineering, aerospace, mechanical engineering, industrial engineering. And they allow to not only to study the behavior of the different dynamic systems, but also to identify which signals or which could be the impact of different interventions or influence of those on those systems. In practice, what we do, now we acquire different imaging modalities for each subject at different time points. We can also incorporate different cognitive behavioral measures. Then we, using a specific brain parcellations, we quantify the brain alterations, the multifactorial brain alterations at different time points. And using the previous defined mathematical model, then we can estimate how the different biological factors are interacting. We can also estimate ways or parameters associated to the factor-specific propagation across each considered brain network. And we can also see or estimate how these factors can, or these interactions and factor spreading effects impact cognitive change, clinical states, and behavioral change. Because we have a causal model, of, let's say once that we feed the data for one subject, we have in some way a causal representation of the different interactions and the different effects that happens in the, that are happening in the brain of that person. So that allows us to go to integrate back in time in order to see which could be the initial triggering event or the initial event that triggered a given disorder. Once that we did that in a population of around 500 patients or participants coming from the ARNI database, and we found that at least at the population level, a vascular alteration was the most likely event triggering sporadic Alzheimer's disease. There are multiple causes why a vascular dysregulation could be associated to the progression of Alzheimer's. Just to mention an example, I will not enter into detail. We know that the vascular system is highly associated to the clearance of proteins and waste products of the brain in relation or associated to the lymphatic flow. However, I think this is, or the finding that the vascular intervention might be the first event is not really so important. Because in fact, once we look, or when we analyze the interaction between the different biological factors, we observe that we cannot remove any of these possible interactions. So to explain the disorder as we know it, we need to, or let's say that there are many different or factor-factor interactions in the brain that cause or triggers a cascade of events and contribute to the progression of the disease, causing the patterns that we know. And for us, or for me, I believe in some way that the initial event is not the most important, because at the end, what is more important are the interaction between the different biological factors. And in fact, different events could cause or could result in the same final disorder. This is interesting, and we could continue discussing a lot about that. And of course, there are a lot of limitations associated to those results. But I didn't mention yet how this could help patients in the practice. one of the most important applications of those dynamic system models is that if we are interested in to cause a given change in the brain, let's say if we are interested in to change the concentration of the misfolded proteins, reduce amyloid plaques or reduce the tau plaques, all what we need to do is to invert the equation, passing to the right side of the equation, the change that we are the desired change. And then we pass to the left side of the equation the standard inputs that we need to introduce. So we keep on the right side of the equation all the other terms, and in that way we could have an estimate of which specific signal, standard signal, we have to introduce in order to cause the desired change. We did that in a population of around 300 subjects, and we obtained, or we tried to estimate how effective it would be to stop neurodegeneration targeting a specific biological factor, the specific biological factors that we were considering. Then we created something that we call the multifactorial intervention fingerprint that reflects how effective, as I mentioned, how effective it would be to stop neurodegeneration targeting all the considered factors. We found something very interesting, but that is just in line with the main ideas of the personalized medicine. So we found that a patient with a given clinical diagnosis like this one, it would be more effective for that patient to target the vascular and the metabolic system. And there are specific interventions already proposed for that. However, for other patients with the same clinical diagnosis, the same cognitive manifestation and same behavioral manifestations, for that patient would be more effective to target the amyloid and tau. So to reduce amyloid and tau in the brain. And there are also specific interventions proposed for that. There are other patients, same diagnosis, same clinical alterations, for which nothing, at least at the single target level, would be effective. And for this kind of patient, what we are proposing that they need is a multifactorial intervention, like doing physical exercise, taking anti-amyloid, anti-tau drugs, giving interventions to improve the vascular and the metabolic system. We also found that the patients don't need, at least in that population, they don't need an infinite or, let's say, interventions of different interventions for each of them, but that the patients, in fact, can be very clearly clusterized according to the treatments that the model is suggesting. And, in fact, we observed that each of these subgroups with different therapeutic needs had specific genetic alterations in the periphery. So they were characterized by a specific subgroup, specific molecular alterations. In addition, combining this with gene expression data or data from the molecular data, we found or we identified the molecular pathways, the alternate molecular pathways for each group, subgroup needing a specific intervention. What we have here in the inner circle are in black, the molecular pathways that were altered in those patients needing a vascular intervention. On the second cycle, then we have the molecular pathways altered for the patients that need an anti-amyloid and then an anti-tau, anti-functional hyperactivity, etc. intervention. Something interesting that we found was that subjects needing a vascular intervention have less molecular pathways altered, and then those having an anti-amyloid intervention have a little more, and those needing an anti-tau intervention have still more and more and more. So this kind of graph also gave us an idea of the disease progression, at least in general in the population, suggesting again that a vascular dysregulation might be the first altered factor in sporadic Alzheimer's disease. However, it's also suggesting that the treatment will change as the disease progresses. So persons, even if we separate the subjects in different subgroups, it's very important to consider not only disease variants, but also disease stage inside each subgroup. In general, or in sum, the multifactorial intervention fingerprint suggests which biological components should be targeted at the individual level, also in which specific brain regions and anatomical vascular connections the intervention should be focused, and which are the molecular pathways linked to the different individual therapeutic needs. If we target different factors or regions or molecular pathways, that could result on strong negative effects, large treatment needs, and higher economic costs. And that's usually what happens until now, and that's associated to the first results that I presented based on the meta-analysis about which drugs or how much drugs are failing. All it needs, of course, this, of course, needs further validation. I will present some results at the end or some analysis that we use or that we are trying to make to validate the how the applicability of the therapeutic fingerprint. Those results present of, for obtaining the multifactorial intervention fingerprint, we need different imaging modalities. And as we know, that's very expensive. And also, we need a high level of expertise to be able to pre-process 6 different imaging modalities. So we are also trying to find alternative to obtain similar information from just peripheral biomarkers. We recently have been working to develop new models that could give similar information, but just based, for example, in a blood test. What we have here is our most recent study or more recent results showing how if we obtain, let's say, gene expression from the blood of a patient, and then we also obtain post-mortem data from the religious other studies and the memory and aging project from Rush University, then we can take that data, let's say all the gene expression from the patient at a given time point, and using a specific unsupervised machine learning techniques, the data can be reduced to a space in which if we order the subjects according to the position that they have in that space or the distance in that space, we will see that the subjects can be clearly positioned in a space in a way in which subjects in one corner will be closer to be free of pathology, and subjects on the other corner of the space will be those subjects that are more advanced in disease. Also, position in the space will be until some point reflecting these different disease variants or different ways to arrive to a same anomaly or same pathological state. Based on the distance of the position on this space and the distance to the background population, that will be those subjects that are not advanced on disease or that are closer to be free of pathology, then we can define a specific, let's say, in this case that we use a gene expression data, we can define specific gene expression pseudotype measures that have been also used in other fields, like in cancer research, and which would be ideally reflecting the time or the relative time that the person has progressed or that has passed in terms of disease progression. So what we obtain in some ways a molecular score of disease progression that could also give information according to the variability in this space of which disease variant is following the person. Also, because this is, we obtain ways associated to the trajectories of the individual trajectories, we can also go back in order to see which were the most informative genes or features on the original data space, and that allows to interpret which are the underlying mechanisms, or at least which are the most predictive features in terms of disease progression and heterogeneity. What we have here is how this molecular disease progression score associated to tau spreading, and we found that it's significantly increased with the BRAC stage and also decreased with the SERA stage that you know is lower when there is more amyloid in the brain. But more interesting, it is it's a better predictor of the comorbidity between between different biological alterations. We found a similar result. This is in Alzheimer's disease in a population of around 489 participants or subjects. And in other population combining both Alzheimer's disease, healthy controls, or subjects that died without any specific disorder, and Huntington, person that has Huntington, we found that the model is also able to capture the disease variability or the differences in disease stage, even when we put all the data together at the beginning. So we just reflected that the model and this kind of model could be useful to track different of to track disease stage and variability, even considering data that involve different disorders. But this is just with post-mortem data. We try to see if that kind of model works also with the in vivo data in order to find those in vivo biomarkers that we are looking for. And we found similar results. The model is like the gene expression serotypes is significantly different for amyloid negative and amyloid positive, the same for tau negative type positive. And it also predicts well if the patients or the participants have amyloid, the combination of amyloid, tau, with brain infarct. So it could not only give information about neuropathology in terms of mephotoproteins, but also if the person have vascular alterations in the brain, and I suppose that could allow also to quantify or predict in an unsupervised way neuropathology, they say, considering all mephotoproteins or inflammatory data, etc. Then we considered, we found that the gene expression pseudotyping is also significantly associated to the clinical state of the patients. But more importantly than that, healthy controls that were stable, that didn't progress, they also have a significantly lower molecular index of disease progression than those subjects that will progress in time. So just having a single blood test could give information about who will progress or not in the next five, six years. We also found that the molecular disease score is significantly correlated with the executive function and memory. However, the effects were not so strong. And for us, when we try to interpret this, our conclusion was that it is good to reflect neuropathology or pathological alterations in general, but it's not specific enough to say or to predict if the alteration will be more like at the executive function or in memory or any specific domain, behavioral or cognitive domain. Then, as I mentioned, we always could analyze the weights obtained by the model in order to identify the most predictive genes and molecular pathways or the most predictive features of all the data included. Something very interesting that we found is that around 85 to 90% of all the molecular pathways identified in the brain, of the top predictive molecular pathways in the brain, were also top predictors in the periphery or in the blood, which highlight again the importance of considering or studying the brain peripheral axis. Now I will just comment briefly about the in-clinic validations and the open access tools that we are developing. We need to show or we need to test if this is the fingerprint works in real life. Let's say if it is able to predict who will respond or not to a given treatment. We have been working for around 2 years with a preclinical Alzheimer's disease population that received an anti-inflammatory intervention. And these are very recent results where we obtained that the fingerprint significantly predicts and explains also response to the anti-inflammatory. That clinical trial, or the main conclusion of that clinical trial, was that the anti-inflammatory was not helping the patients. But those results were based on the comparison between all the patients that took the drug and the placebo group. However, when we analyzed the study using a personalized approach, we found that, in fact, some patients have a higher tendency, or let's say that the disease, there was a significant slow effect, or the drug caused a deceleration on the progression of the disease in those patients, while in other ones it caused an acceleration. And we saw that the fingerprint, taking only baseline data, was able to say which patient would be in one corner and the other one. We're analyzing now how exactly the drug causes that. And we are trying also to give this information to the clinics and the industry in order to allow them to get or perform better patient selection for the next clinical trials. We are also trying the same. We are trying to predict treatment response to levodopa or levodopa in Parkinson's disease. And we are analyzing data also from a clinical trial with ultrasound surgery in order to see if the models can predict a response to treatment or not, and also to explain why or not, at least at the macroscopic level. All these methods are also implemented in a software that we are going to make available in the 1 or 2 months. And the software we have from the different models implemented, including the identification of pseudotypes and pseudo gene expression trajectories. You could also introduce any kind of data there, which can also be used after, let's say, if you have only cross-sectional data, that could give you a pseudo-temporal information to that could be used later in dynamic systematic analysis, and we have some ways of validating how good or not that would be. We also have the epidemic spreading model, multifactorial Gaussian model that I explained it, and the personalized fingerprint. But we are also extending all these models to integrate. I said the fingerprint is only including a multimodal brain imaging, but we are extending it to have inside also gene expression, methylation, more molecular information, and the same with the trajectories inference models. In summary, we started analyzing how the mesothelioproteins propagate in the brain, and then we extended those models to consider intra or local interfactors interactions at the regional level, and how these interactions affect the clinical and cognitive states of the patients, which would be the macroscopic, optimal macroscopic signals to consider at the individual level. As I mentioned, what we are doing now is to work on the validation with real clinical trials, and also we are including in the mathematical formulations, gene expression, genotyping, methylation, proteins concentration, like more detailed molecular data that would allow us not only to identify which would be the optimal treatments at the macroscopic level, but also at the molecular level. That's all. Thank you. I would like to thank the students and new students in my lab, also collaborator Yasha, and the funding sources. Thanks. Yes, multiple ways to do that. So I will start with the sample of the clinical trial that we just analyzed for the in collaboration with the Douglas Hospital. We only used T1 image from them. So they have vascular functional, but the vascular and functional data was used in so different way that the way that we analyzed a different angle that we decided to only use the structural image. So then they say we have all the angle data set for which the patients could have like six different MI modalities sometimes. And then we try to see, we calculate how similar or the distance from just using the T1 to the T1 on the other side. And in that way, we translated the fingerprints to that database. That's one way, but it's not the best one. What we are doing now, in addition, is to reduce or identify which are the really necessary modalities to obtain the same information. And we are doing that with brain imaging, but also with molecular data. So we are working on, let's say, multi-omics integration, which could give a lot of more information than using only one modality. However, we are trying to see until which point we really need to have like methylation and gene expression and genotyping. So there is we have a specific modes to reduce the feature space, or even using the same model that with the trajectory inference that give at the end ways to the initial features in the initial space. And in that way, we're trying to see if we can define what is really necessary for this population that is analyzed. There are also other ways you could have, let's say, if we know a priori the ways in which different modalities interact, we can add that inside of the models. And even if you have missing data, you obtain, or the model can give you like predicted values for the missing data that you have. I suppose there are, could be, I don't know, up to 5 or probably more ways to deal with that, or to reduce the necessary information. What we would like to do is to compare all of them because we are not sure of which would be the best alternative yet. It's okay. No. Well, there are different studies, and I like Alex will present later other ways to identify subtypes. In neurodegeneration, there are a lot of papers now coming out proposing different numerous subtypes or different ways to identify the subtypes. I'm not sure that we are going to find an optimal number at the end. I think, let's say, in our case, what we like to do. It's not to subtype the patients according to the cross-sectional properties or the multifactorial properties only, but also according to how they will respond to treatment. So it's in some way a different question. So if you follow them longitudinally, and you have they could be different at one time point or more similar between them. But the question for us is not only how they aggregate or they group at a specific time point, but also it's like if you introduce an intervention, how they will respond. And in fact, persons with similar characteristics at baseline don't have why to respond similarly later to a given intervention. And well, Erica was talking about that too.
And that's better aligned with what we pay attention to in the clinic in any case.
Yeah.
That's what's going to change or not.
Yeah. Yes, probably at the end, the idea will be dynamic interventions and not only like selecting the best intervention at one time point and that's it. So probably. It's a dynamic system, right? So if you move the system by one side, it will tend to move in one direction, and then you have to push it in that direction. Probably that will conduce to something stable at some point. Or maybe it's normal like with aging, like having neurodegeneration is totally normal too, and that responds to some effects and some causes that we probably never be able to stop, unless maybe gene therapies or something, but adding in general terms. It's normal to have that aging neurodegeneration processes. So what we are trying to do is in some way to compensate. And to compensate, we have to consider the time variable too. So how the patient will be in the future and not only in the present. Yes, let's say that you get a fingerprint, so that is something like this, but in this case we only have like six values. We could have a lot more because you could consider all the combinations between the different biological factors. And as I mentioned, this is just, until now it's only at the macroscopic level. We are extending it to the microscopic level too. So once that you obtain this, then you can use this just like futures to predict who's going to, or if someone will respond or not in the future, and then you train that in a given population. Once you have a new patient, you calculate the score, etc. However, you also have, let's say, if the clinical trial is already finished, or the data, you have already longitudinal data for each person, you could also estimate the matrix or the parameters associated or let's say to the change in that person. And you also have parameters associated to the effect that the input is having on the person. So that gives you, allows you to see how this parameter change in relation with the intervention. And that's what we are doing now. So they said that we are finding that the persons that reply positively to the intervention, to the anti-inflammatory, they have different capacities to, or the system was moving in a way or functioning in a way that allowed that treatment to respond to them, while the other ones not or done. Or in fact, those ones that have negative effects, we could see exactly which of these parameters was altered by or affected by the intervention.
So it's by surveying the model that fits the parameters of your model.
Yes.
Surveying that, and that's what you let me explain and not just.
Yes. So far it's just a macroscopic explanation. which could be still very useful. They said in that intervention, specific intervention, we are finding that that drug, those persons that responded well, for some reason, their vascular system was better auto-controlled compared with those ones that didn't respond. And then considering that, as you know, of you have some information about the drug mechanisms or the mechanism that the specific drug that you are considering should be targeting, then you can make some interpretations. But this will be a lot more detailed when we incorporate the molecular information.
For our last talk of the morning, we welcome Dr. Ralina Thomas, who is a postdoctoral researcher here at the Montreal Neurological Institute, where she is developing analysis tools for human-induced pluripotent stem cells differentiated into neurons in 3D tissue models, so-called mini-brains. Ralina is working toward integrating transcriptional sequencing data with cell imaging data to understand the pathological processes of Parkinson's disease. So we are very pleased to welcome her today to talk to us about whether we can better understand the relationship between stem cells and neurons using computational models. It should come up on screen fairly soon.
Thank you to the organizers for inviting me to speak. It's a real privilege, and it's been a really interesting day so far. I'm going to talk about cell biology right now a little bit. Well, more specifically, I'm going to talk about neurons and how we might use computational approaches to better learn from